Friends, on behalf of SACAR and myself, I welcome you all to this workshop. Which is specially designed as per the wishes of Dikshit Bhai for those who are more or less introduced to Sri Aurobindo and the Mother. Frankly, I have prepared for all of you a journey through Sri Aurobindo's highlights of his thought and vision. That means I would be taking you through his major works. It will be more or less an overview because you know the course that I've prepared and that is in front of me. I think I can take you for a whole month. Sri Aurobindo has written 38 volumes. It is not a joke to cover him. So it will be unfair to say that I'm going to give you highlights, but just an overview of the scriptures, that is Vedas and Vedanta. Especially, I will be covering the Isha Upanishad tomorrow. And then day after, I will be giving you some insights in the Bhagavad Gita. I mean, I know many of you are here who are quite masters in the Vedas, Vedanta, and I hear there is somebody here who has even given talks at Nainital on the Vedanta. So, I have selected most important event or the concept of each of these books, from Isha, from the Bhagavad Gita, and then I'll be taking you to the master vision, that is the life divine, the Sri Aurobindo's essential philosophy. After that, I will take you through his integral yoga. And then if my breath lasts, I will leave it with Savitri. So, it's quite a huge journey. So, that is the preparation I'm giving you, that is going to be a very wide and a very long journey. And today I would like to take up the person that is Sri Aurobindo. Now, having said that in the introduction, I hear both Shruti and Dikshit Bhai telling that I have read so much, Satra Sal Maka Satha, Bahut Kuch Padha, Mataji Mujhe Life Divine Blessing Diya Tha and synthesis and such baat, she has blessed me on all that. But frankly, how much I have understood, I doubt it. Mataji to apna grace se diya mujhe blessings. But I doubt if anyone can at all understand him. Sri Aurobindo ko samajhna easy baat nahi hai. Because you see, somebody asked the mother, when she was in Japan for 4 years, 1916 to 1920. There was a friend of the mother very close to her. So somebody from India went to see Japan where the mother was living and he met the friend. And he asked her, what is your impression of the mother? Because they have been friends for 4 years and they have been staying together. And the lady gave a beautiful reply. She said, The mother is like Mount Fuji. You know what's Mount Fuji? Like the Himalayas of India, they are the Fuji. So why do you say so? He said, I was so close to her, I couldn't understand her. Very beautiful, he said. Because when you are close to a mountain, you don't see the top of the mountain, you don't see the peaks of the mountain. You just see the first rocks, first beautiful, you know, little peak. He said, she's so big, I can't understand her. Similar is Sri Aurobindo. We all think, humko samajhte hain, ladies bolti hai ki haan, life divine pad liya, synthesis pad liya karte. Because you see, we are in the present. I've been living, not with is the wrong word, at the time of the mother, 17, 18 years. So we are so close in the present with the mother and Sri Aurobindo that we don't understand them at all. We think we understand. Hum bhi padhe hain, hum bhi 30 mark hain, life divine 4 baar padhe, Savitri 10 baar padhe. What happens? And dusri ajeeb baat hai, the more you reach Sri Aurobindo, the less you understand him. Recently I was telling a friend of mine, you know, after all these years from 1969, I'm supposed to have graduated from Sri Aurobindo International School. So almost it's 50 years. And somebody asked me, Anand Bhai, what is it you have learned at the end of the day? I said, I've learned only one thing. I am really ignorant. The more you read, the more ignorant you are. Because reading has no value unless it is backed up by experience and practice. There was a disciple of Sri Ramakrishna who asked him, Thakur, that you say Kalima is so big and so such a big powerful personality, but I see in your temple a small idol of Kali. Why do you say she is so big? And Sri Ramakrishna takes him out of the temple and says, Bhaira, come outside. Say, do you see the sun there? Bolta, haan. Tum dikh raha na? Can you see it? Yes, yes. But do you think the sun is only that big? Bolta, no, bahut badi hai. Then how are you seeing it? You are able to see even that much sun because you are very far from it. So the closer you go, the thing vanishes. So my message is Sri Aurobindo ke baare mein, and maa ka diye bhi. The more you want to approach them, the more they lose their form. I mean, from a distance I can see a form called the mother, a form called Sri Aurobindo. But when you approach them, the form vanishes. You begin to realize only a consciousness, a power, love, grace, which is not, which is beyond this form. So what I want to tell you is that many of us, we think we know Sri Aurobindo, we have understood Sri Aurobindo and the mother, but it is only a thought, imagination. In reality, there are very few. In fact, there are people, like, you know, we have the great Romain Rolland, there's a Western philosopher, who says, last of the great rishis, Sri Aurobindo holds in his outstretched hand the bow of creative impulse. I mean, yeah, in his own time when he was writing the Arya, even after that, people have read the Life Divine, his books, and they have come to understand that he is a great personality who is holding the world in his outstretched hands. And then there is one gentleman professor again, Robert McDermott, president of CIIS, who said, Sri Aurobindo is the most complete yogi of modern India. And differently from traditional and modern yoga, his is influenced and enriched by the vision of a transformed world. So he catches the philosophy of the transformation of the world, of the earth. You see, you can dig up some books and you will see praises galore from the West and East and Tagore and everybody. But I feel all these are only mind's understanding, which means very shallow, very close, very little. The only understanding, perhaps the right understanding, would come only from the mother. Because she alone was that of the same height of his consciousness. As I told you, if you climb a peak, Sri Aurobindo's consciousness is always in a higher peak and the next higher peak. In fact, there was a professor here, Professor Aurobindo Basu, who in a national seminar opened the seminar with a grand sentence. I always remember that. Sri Aurobindo is like the Brahman. Why? He says you cannot understand him. Because Sri Aurobindo you cannot understand easily because he is multifaceted. He is not just a saint or a poet or a philosopher or a revolutionist. He is all this together. And for us human beings, for common understanding, we seek one personality. Oh, he is a revolutionary, it's easy. He is a poet, we can go. But it is very difficult for human beings with a limited mind to gauge the multi-personality. Not only the multi-personality, the multi-tiers of his consciousness. You see, level after level, level after level, he keeps on going. The higher you go, he is always in front of you. That's what Isha Upanishad told us, we are going to see tomorrow. That the Supreme is always away, one step ahead of you. Not one step, many steps maybe. So these are the things that we should understand when we claim to understand Sri Aurobindo because we are read so much so. Same thing with the mother. We are not dealing with the mother, but same thing. So we should not claim much of an understanding just because we happen to give some lectures and classes and take seminars. As I told you, the only person to really give us a proper understanding of Sri Aurobindo is the mother alone. So, in one of the occasions, mother told the ashram children, you are trying to show the continuity of history with Sri Aurobindo as the outcome, the culmination. It is false entirely. And she reiterated, Sri Aurobindo does not belong to the past nor to history. So this is the right way of looking at Sri Aurobindo. He does not belong to the past nor to history. Normally what we do, what we think, is that Sri Aurobindo is the culmination of a movement in India or in the world. All the great philosophers, right from the Vedas and Upanishads and the Gita and the six systems and the Acharyas and all that, and then comes Sri Aurobindo, the culmination, the peak of all the spirituality, be it philosophy, be it literature, and we say, oh, Savitri, the greatest epic. So we have a common way of putting Sri Aurobindo as the culmination. Any thought, social thought, political thought, literature, philosophy, spirituality. But mother has with one blow washed out this kind of understanding, she says, he belongs neither to past nor even to history. So the first thing that we should do is never to bring him into human history, saying that there were these things and now comes Sri Aurobindo. So that was quite a revelation when I read that from the mother. Because she would say that the Sri Aurobindo is outside and beyond of history, and the understanding is he belongs to the future. So this is the right way of approaching Sri Aurobindo. And I'm telling this to all of you. Some of you may be quite new to Sri Aurobindo, absolutely new to his thought. But here in this session, I'm going to present exactly most of it from Mother and Sri Aurobindo, so I don't mix up my own opinion or my judgment, my interpretation. So I'm giving you what the mother told us. So he is not wanting to belong to a kind of a culmination, a basin, as somebody says, is, you know, in which all the philosophies are poured into Sri Aurobindo as the biggest container. So here is a personality whom we try to understand, but he always escapes us. So with this remarkable insight into Sri Aurobindo as a person and his work, the mother in one of her talks says, his Sri Aurobindo is an eternal birth. Sri Aurobindo is an eternal birth. When somebody was asking the mother to comment upon his birth, she says, his is an eternal birth. Now, I'd like all of you to remember this phrase, an eternal birth. What does it mean? Because birth is in time, but eternity is beyond time. So, after a few days, somebody asked the mother, what do you mean by this eternal birth? We don't understand. And I've taken a clue from there, from the mother's explanation, to see what exactly has been Sri Aurobindo's vision, role, and the mission. Because, you know, some of you who have been talking about Sri Aurobindo's life and Sri Aurobindo's work and all that, you have all talked about Mother and Sri Aurobindo being against one point, that we should not give the details of their outer life. Because they said, outwardly, it's all fine. But nobody here knows our inner journey. So how can you present a biography of Sri Aurobindo and the mother when we have hardly any knowledge of what they have been, what they have been, their journey inwardly? Externally, yes, people have sorted out their life into four levels, you know, London and then Baroda and then Calcutta and then the Puducherry. Then you say London is Brahmacharya, Baroda is, you know, Grihastha Ashrama, Calcutta is Vanaprastha, and Puducherry has been Sannyas. All kinds of divisions have been there. But all there is only external way of describing his life. But Sri Aurobindo and the mother, they don't approve. It's outwardly, it's quite a common life. People have gone abroad, come Baroda, served here, served there. So it has been quite a puzzle for me, then how do we present their life? And that presentation was given to me. The secret is, in the single phrase, Sri Aurobindo is an eternal birth. And what does it mean? We will see. You see, normally we all start telling that Sri Aurobindo was born on Thursday, 15th of August, 24 minutes before sunrise. That's the usual date of birth, time of birth and all that. But my contention is that he was never born. He took a birth. You understand the meaning, the difference. Born we are all, we are all born on a particular day, particular time, particular parents, particular. Ours is a kind of a birth which comes incognito. We don't even know why we have come upon earth. But here was a personality who took birth, that means who came consciously. He came consciously in a country, in a family, in a particular time to do something positive. For not for his family, not for his country, for the world, for humanity. So here was a mission birth. Not somebody was born on 15th of August. Thousands are born on 15th of August, so what? But only one person took birth, saying that I have come with a special mission. And he said, and the mother says in one of her declarations, Sri Aurobindo came upon earth, not born. Sri Aurobindo came upon earth to announce the manifestation of the supermental world. And not only did he announce this manifestation, but he also embodied in part the supramental force and gave us the example of what we must do to prepare ourselves for this manifestation. The best thing we can do is to study all he has told us, strive to follow his example and prepare ourselves for the new manifestation. So friends, remember these things. Sri Aurobindo came upon earth to announce the manifestation of the supramental world. This nobody has done it, nobody can do it, nobody could do it. We have had hundreds and thousands of saints and sages and rishis from the Vedic times to the present times in all parts of the country. But there's only one Sri Aurobindo who came not to be one more yogi, one more saint, one more kavi, but to announce the manifestation of the supramental world. What it means, we'll see tomorrow when we take up the lecture, the philosophy. That means he has come to declare to humanity a new world. Not just to tinkering this world, how to make it socially better, take away this law, take away. He's not tinkering this world. He didn't want to tinker this. There are a lot of politicians and social revolutions and political revolutions and literature revolutions, religious revolutions, which are all tinkering the world. Sri Aurobindo said, no. I will throw this ignorant world out, bring in a new one. Well, what is that throwing away? It doesn't mean demolish the world. I'll tell you the meaning later. So here was a person who really brought in, announced the birth of a new world called the supramental world. Number one. Number two, not only did he announce the manifestation, but also embodied. This is again important, friends, you should understand. You see, there are many poets, many people, maybe some, you know, avant-garde, those who have a vision of the future, they can say that a new world is coming. In fact, there was one person, Max Theon, who said there is going to be a new world beyond humanity. He announced it. So Sri Aurobindo is not just the announcer, but he has embodied. That's the important word. That means he has brought the supramental force and consciousness in his own body, in his own birth. So this no Vedic Rishi has done, no Upanishad Rishi has done, no Gita Yogin has done. So Sri Aurobindo is not only the announcer of the new world, but embodied the consciousness of the new world, the supramental consciousness. And she says, embodied in part the supramental force. And then it says, third point, that it says, that he has been an example of what we must do to prepare ourselves. So these are the three things for which he has come: announcer, embodiment, and preparing us. And this is of the most important point, to prepare ourselves for this manifestation. And the mother would later on explain, I mean, I tell you now, a lot of things to tell you, so hold on. So the thing is, he has asked us how to prepare for this new world. So you can see the gigantic work is not done, has not been done till now by anyone. So this is the mission for which he took birth. And then the mother, when she was asked the question about this eternal birth, she gives a wonderful explanation. And now this is the line in which Sri Aurobindo should be looked at. So for those of you who are the speakers on Sri Aurobindo's life and birth, let us change the track now. Let us not say anymore he was born in here, work in there, Baroda, he was college, he was all that, take any book you'll find. But the inner meaning of Sri Aurobindo's birth is this, what the mother herself told us. She says, this birth, eternal birth, is there on four levels: physical, mental, psychic, and spiritual. What does it mean? She says, on the physical level, it means that the consequences of this birth will last as long as the earth. The consequences of Sri Aurobindo's birth will be felt throughout the entire existence of the earth. So now start understanding the meaning of the eternal birth. On the physical level, she says, as long as the earth remains, he will be remembered. Why? You will say, well, we also remember Krishna, we also remember Rama. Fine. Obviously, you will remember Krishna and Rama because of the work they have done for the sake of humanity and the earth. There are many others who come and go, but we remember these avataric births. So it is these avatars who have been remembered by the earth consciousness. So she says that the consequences of this birth will last as long as the earth. Well, if you take the case of Sri Krishna, you will say, oh my God, we all remember he is the great avatar, he is great lord, he is my this thing. What do you remember of Sri Krishna? You will say about his Leela, about his Mahabharata, about his Gita. You say, oh my God, Lord Krishna, Bhagavad Gita. It has been 2000 years, 4000 years, 5000 years, we don't know. And still the memory is as fresh. And he also will be remembered as long as the earth remains. So now, coming to Sri Aurobindo. If I ask you, what is that Sri Aurobindo will be remembered for on the earth level, on the physical level? There are a couple of things, there could be many. But you know, I have dug out only two important things. They are exactly, very similar to what Sri Krishna himself did. We will come to Sri Krishna when we take up the Gita day after tomorrow. You see, one of the things that Sri Krishna did for India was to give India the unity. For the first time, somebody worked for the oneness, unity of the country. Today we have the famous word Akhanda Bharat. The first man, the first person to imagine an Akhanda Bharat was Sri Krishna. And similar lines, Sri Aurobindo, but the first person who really dreamt of a free India, Purna Swaraj, Sampurna Swaraj, absolute Swaraj. No one else spoke of this Sampurna Swaraj as a Purna Swaraj. We were all, you know, with the Britishers, with the Congress, with this party, that party, saying, oh, let us be happy with a little begging bowl, with a little partition country. Sri Aurobindo said, no, this is our country and we have the right to be free. So on the one level, if you see, Sri Aurobindo was a great, in fact, as somebody writes, was undoubtedly the revolutionist of the age, both in the inner world and the outer. He was convinced that it is only by securing India's freedom and culture that humanity's future would be secured. Hence, the first thing that he did when he returned from England was that he fought for the motherland, but not with the power of a gun or a sword, but with that of his pen. Now, this is the first thing that we should understand. You see, even before Sri Aurobindo came on the scene of India's freedom movement, there have been small pockets. In fact, 1957 onwards, we have been having these revolutionary movements to free the country. But what exactly did Sri Aurobindo do and contribute? One thing that he writes himself is that there is the urgent need to revive the power of the ideal. This is Sri Aurobindo's contribution. That you see, you cannot have the Kshatriyahood, you cannot have a revolutionary until and unless you have the ideal in front. So the most important thing is to create the ideal, to give an ideal to the people. Otherwise, if we just say, come on all of us, let's revolt and break their heads and kill some Britishers, it doesn't hold. It's kind of an excitement, he says. Out of an excitement, you can revolt and kill some people and come back. But Sri Aurobindo realizes that first of all, India has to be free, because for the sake of the earth, for the sake of humanity, number one. But how will it be free? The most important thing is the ideal. You see, we all in our own lifetimes, we have seen all the great movements are there because of the ideal. India's revolution, you can call it any empire. You have the French Revolution, you have the Russian Revolution. Everywhere, first the idealist was born. It is not the armies that were born. The ideal is born. You see, French Revolution, you know, that famous phrase that liberty, equality, fraternity. The three words, that was the ideal. And from that single mantra of the liberty, equality, fraternity, whole revolution was born. There were armies, there was revolution, there was killing and all that. Empires, the kingdoms, the kings were pulled down only because of that single ideal. So Sri Aurobindo too says that in Indian freedom movement, what is lacking is the ideal. So there have been great people in Maharashtra and Gujarat and Calcutta who have been trying to give an ideal. But an ideal that was to throw away the Britishers, to counter the Britishers. But here was Sri Aurobindo who says no. Not to throw away the Britishers or to kill them. The ideal was to revive India's ancient culture. This is something that we should all understand. You see, India's freedom did not come because of this movement and Dandi March and that march and this revolution. Those are all the outer expressions. You know, burning foreign goods, you make a big heap of fire and then put all your foreign... Those are all things that came up later. But the first thing that came up was the ideal and the word Vande Mataram itself. That was the mantra by which the ideal was, you know, awakened in the country. So please do not think that the outer activities of revolts and this march and that killing and this satyagraha, they come only after the ideal. So Sri Aurobindo's main work, main contribution for the freedom of the country has been to provide the ideal. In fact, in one of his writings, in his Bengali writings, he would say that Kshatriyahood bereft of strength of the Brahmin may end up in uncontrollable titanism. That means this Kshatriyahood without Brahminism, that means arms, the power without the ideal, will end up in uncontrollable titanism. That means the power will just start killing meaninglessly. There will be titanism, there will be no control. The Brahmanism, the ideal is first thing. And he would say, and once the ideal is given, the Kshatriya comes. And you see, if you go into Indian history, I mean, there are a lot of details from Maharashtra to Gujarat to everywhere. But essentially, there are two things that have come up. Once the idealism was given by Sri Aurobindo, that gives birth to the Kshatriya. And in India, apart from all the Indian revolutionaries, Bengal and Maharashtra, they are all small revolutions. The real power was Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. So here we have wonderful balance, the Brahmin and the Kshatriya. But first came the Brahmin. Brahmin means not the jati, is not the caste, not the creed. Brahmin is the knowledge, the ideal. So once Sri Aurobindo in this, what, hardly 1905 to 1907, 8, 4, 5 years. But his Bande Mataram was the great tool to spread this ideal. And with that awoke, the Indian masses awoke. And during the same time, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose was preparing the Indian National Army. And in fact, Netaji, in one of his talks, he says, Sri Aurobindo, Aurobindo Ghosh at the time he was called, he has been my political guru. So you see, we get a completely different vision of the national movement. Instead of going into all these divisions and these little individuals and all that. So it's become very clear, the ideal and the force. Ideal must come first and then the force is followed. And with this force, in later on we come to read in some of this present information. Who was that British ruler who left India? Last. Huh? No, the last viceroy? Mountbatten. Mountbatten, in his memories, he writes that actually we left India because of Netaji, not because of any other movement. You must have heard so much in your history. He says, we knew one thing. After the war, it is Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose's, his army would take over the British people, British army. And before that happens, we left India. Because we saw the wave of this Netaji's army coming up. And this is the main reason, Viceroy says, that we decided to quit the country. See, most of these things are not known all these years. They have been submerged under some policies. But the truth is now coming up, and I'm sure the future generations will bring out the greater truth. And this now you see, now you can see your Gokhale and all the Maharashtrian great leaders, they come under this ideal, the club of the idealism with Sri Aurobindo as the leader. And then the Bengal comes under Netaji, and all the Punjab people who revolted, all that comes under strength. So this is the real image we get of the Indian freedom movement. And Sri Aurobindo was that leader. And then he was not only writing the Bande Mataram, he was also teaching in a nationalist school purposely founded to contrast the British education system, directing the extremist party which demanded complete independence from the UK, organizing guerrilla actions and sabotage all across India, and presiding at most of the important meetings of that period. It is indeed hard to think of anyone more active than Sri Aurobindo in those years. Up to his neck, he was in fighting the power, in fighting the powerful of the world, whom he had begun to see as simple puppets in the hands of the occult forces. So, just to give you one idea, that he fought for the freedom of the country, not with arms, but with the power of the pen. Because that is the rhythm of any revolution. If you go back into history, everywhere the ideal comes first, the execution comes next. Well, a little incident of how this great yogi perform, had his great vision of the future. All of you know about the Cripps proposal. You know, the Cripps proposal, when it was given to India, our Indian leaders, they declined it. But Sri Aurobindo was one of the many, at least one of the strongest persons who have supported that. You see, again, our political leaders were blind. But here was a yogi who could see the future. Had we accepted the Cripps proposal, we wouldn't be facing it today, the situation that we are in with our great neighbors. That's one little incident. Now, second incident. One is the country's freedom. We shall always remember by India, just as we remember Sri Krishna's Kurukshetra war for the last centuries and centuries. For the next centuries, India's freedom movement will be rightly remembered, not because of the politicians, but because of the spiritual leader. Now, next we come to another incident that took place at that time. You see, the incident, all of you know, in the 30s and 40s, what was the major incident? That the World War. Now, here was a yogi who was working not just for the country's liberation, but he himself participated in World War I and in World War II, especially in World War II. How did he participate? Did he go and fight the Germans? No, he didn't have to go to fight. But what did he do in the first in the first instance? He didn't go to fight and he didn't have a gun in his hand to shoot the British. He gave the ideal. Similarly, in the second instance, which is a world incident, he gave, once again, not only the ideal, which could not be there because the world was too big for him to spread his word through Vande Mataram. But now what he did was to send his own power and spiritual force. This is how Sri Aurobindo acted on this world forces supporting the British. You see, on the national level he was against the British, but on the world level he was for the British. A lot of this, even ashram disciples and many of his followers in India, they said, how come Aurobindo goes, Mr. Aurobindo goes, you are supporting the British, they are our occupation, they are our enemies. But Sri Aurobindo said, no, and we are supporting the Britishers for a greater reason, which most of you will not understand. But again, the same question of understanding. When he openly supported the Britishers, we come across a letter by our great leader, Mr. Gandhi, who wrote a letter to the British Parliament. He says, you want to kill Nazism? I want you to fight Nazism without arms, with non-violent arms. I would like you to lay down the arms you have as being useless for saving you or humanity. Imagine the advice he gives to the British to lay down arms. Where would we be today? And you know where we would be today? I'll read out Sri Aurobindo. He says, the victory of one side, the Allies, would keep the path open for the evolutionary forces. The victory of the other side would drag back humanity, degrade it horribly, and might lead even at the worst to its failure as a race, as others in the past evolution failed and perished. Now you understand one of the meanings of the birth of Sri Aurobindo. If that person in the past, his meaning was to save this adharma in the time of Kurukshetra, here was the adharma in our present times, in the times of Sri Aurobindo. What was the adharma? The Hitler, the forces of Hitler. So he says, you people are supporting the Britishers, but if they won, there would be the possibility of evolution. But if the Nazis win, he says, this would drag back humanity, degrade it horribly, and might lead even at the worst to its failure as a race. So Sri Aurobindo wants, if the Germans had won, today perhaps in all these 50 years, 70 years, humanity would be in its worst crisis, and maybe that human race would have been wiped off. And in another conversation, he says, human evolution would regress by 2000 years minimum. All this, who would understand? Not our political leaders. Somebody was telling him, put down your arms and go and beg to the Nazi fellow, say, please save us. So here is the great, revolutionary yogi, who was fighting with evolutionary forces, not with Axis and allies. So he says, no, Germany would take back evolution 2000 years back and even wipe out human race possibly. So he saw that this is the danger. And this is the danger because in one of my trips to Germany, I saw where the Hitler was invoking the black sun. Black sun means as against the supramental sun. On one side, in the 30s and 40s, Sri Aurobindo was bringing down the supermind, whereas Hitler was bringing down an asura which he called as the black sun. And there was a specific temple like thing, like a very far imitation of Matri Mandir, with the same 12 pillars and 12 same seats. And he was invoking the asura at that time. And all of you know the story of the mother confronting asura, this asuric force, which was guiding Hitler to destroy Russia, to destroy England, to destroy this. And the mother herself had to intervene to say, no, this asuric forces is misleading Hitler. So she plays some tricks and whatever, that's a big story. So what I want to tell you is that on the physical level, humanity will remember two instances as long as the earth lasts. One is the freedom of the country, the other saving humanity from an utter destruction in the few coming years. So if you want to see what is the mission that Sri Aurobindo has had, for which he will be ever remembered on the physical level, many other instances, small and big, I am not recounting, but these are the events, India and the world. So he came to save India, he came to save the world. So I would put together these two instances, and which would be ever remembered. One last point before I leave you. You see, how could Sri Aurobindo succeed in such events? You say he was a politician, he was a yogi, he was a writer, he was a journalist. But there's one secret. And the secret is, he writes, my own life and my yoga have always been, since my coming to India, both this-worldly and otherworldly, without any exclusiveness on either side. All human interests are, I suppose, this-worldly, and most of them have entered into my mental field, and some, like politics, into my life. But at the same time, since I set foot on Indian soil on the Apollo Bandar in Bombay, I began to have spiritual experiences. But these were not divorced from this world, but had an inner and intimate bearing on it, such as a feeling of the infinite pervading material space and the immanent inhabiting the material objects and bodies. At the same time, I found myself entering supraphysical worlds and planes with these influences and an effect from them upon the material plane. So I could make no sharp divorce or irreconcilable opposition between what I have called the two ends of existence. In my yoga also, I found myself moved to include both worlds in my purview, spiritual and material, and try to establish the divine consciousness and the divine power. This is the secret. Here was a man who was leading a parallel consciousness, the outer and the inner. He never said, oh, I have to be a sannyasi, leave all this and go to Puducherry or to Himalayas or to Burma. He was thick in the activity, as you have seen. He was a politician, he was a journalist, he was a writer, he was a speaker, he was a teacher. And yet through all this, he was living a parallel inner life. You see, during these days of Baroda and Calcutta, he had his greatest experiences, what in spirituality, in Sri Aurobindo's terms, we call as the individual, the universal and the transcendental. And outside, he was serving under the Gaikwad. He was going with him to Kashmir. He was in Calcutta. And yet, you see, the life of this yogi, the spirituality was parallel. And that is the secret of our work. This is the period, what we say, the period of the Karma Yoga. But Karma Yoga is not just action, throwing bombs or writing Vande Mataram. There was a parallel consciousness where, you know, the individual divine, he sees his own Atman in Baroda, as all of you know. He has this universal divine, he sees him in the Vasudeva in the Alipur jail. He has a transcendental divine in Kashmir. So you see, he was already going through these steps of sadhana. So which were peak experiences in spirituality, and yet outside, he was not relenting, he was not stopping, he was not neglecting any of his works, and multiple works. He was the writer, etc. So this is the secret of spiritual life, Sri Aurobindo's spiritual life, that one leads both the paths together. So then and then only you get the strength, the shakti necessary for doing the outer work. We think I'm a revolutionary, I'm an activist, I'm this and this, and we neglect our spiritual life. We say, oh, baad mein dekha jayega, 60 saal ke baad dekhunga. He said, no. It is the inner which supplies the fuel. It's the inner which supplies the ideal. It's the inner which supplies the strength. Because it's always the divine within that guides you properly, that takes you on the right road. So we are the mental creatures, we think that is the mind that is creating, is the mind, I go to pujas, I do this, mind, mental cognition. But here was Sri Aurobindo, who said the inner will guide the outer. That is why when he went to his guru Lele, he said, I don't want to do yoga for myself, for my mukti, for my sadhana. I want to do this yoga so that I can get power to liberate the country. He said, not for myself. We do yoga for my salvation, for my mukti. So here was Sri Aurobindo, who wanted to draw on his inner powers so that the outer world can be changed. So this is the secret of his dynamism. And not just one phase after the other, he became a sannyasi and he became a grihastha ashram. No. So that's why he says that this is why, as the mother said, Sri Aurobindo would be remembered on the physical level for as long as the earth exists. Now she comes to the mental level, but that is a different phase, which is the eighth period of the Jnana Yoga. First one was the yoga of divine works. Second one is the yoga of divine knowledge.